In the beginning, there was a big bang. Not this big bang. Months later, as shown by an updated video by Hardware Busters, this issue seemed to have been resolved. I've also contacted quite a few reputable dealers from Malaysia, and they all told me that they haven't received a single case like that. So, touch wood. But damn, what a spark of drama, huh? So what's the deal with PSUs? How do they work? And how do you know if it is dodgy inside? Your mother no teach? I teach you lah! Full disclosure, this video is brought to you by Gigabyte, who sent over these three power supplies for me to tear apart and check out. But we do reserve our right to an unbiased opinion because I'm a bangsawan, not a sellout. Without further ado, let's get cracking. Okay, I'm not gonna go too in-depth about the issues surrounding the Gigabyte PSUs, particularly the GPP850GM and the GPP750GM. So if you guys wanna find out more, just Google lah. Allegedly, this has something to do with the protection circuits. In this case, it is the OPP or the overpower protection and the OCP, which is the overcurrent protection, being set too high. This would potentially lead to them being triggered when it's too late, when the system's already way overloaded. And that would lead to the issues mentioned. Anyhow, the PSUs we have today are not the scandalous ones. Firstly, we have the GPUD850GM, which is the updated model. Then we have this bigger boy, which is the UD1000GM, which is, well, 1000 watts. And of course, we have the motherload, the flagship GPAP1200PM. Don't simply PM me. GM is for gold, PM is for platinum. Like that, so don't know. See? Your mother didn't teach, ma. I teach you. Today, we're gonna talk a little bit more about how a PSU works and what makes a good PSU and potentially where manufacturers can cut costs. If you wanna find out how to pick the right PSU for you, then feel free to check out our other Your Mother No Teach video, huh? Link in the description. And let's get into it, lah. Get it into. So, how does a PSU actually work?
It supplies power.
Wow, so clever. Your mother must be very proud. Basically, a PSU is a unit that converts the alternating current or AC from your wall socket, and in Malaysia we get 240 volts, into a lower voltage DC or direct current that is more suitable for everyday use. For the PC, we are looking at 12 volts, negative 12 volts, 5 volts and 3.3 volts. PSUs are split into two sections, primary and secondary. The primary section deals with the input voltage from your main, so it can be efficiently changed to the voltage your PC needs. The secondary section deals with the rest of the processes that happen after the input voltage has been converted into a usable voltage. Again, power supply units come in different form factors and specs. To find out which is right for you, then check out our other Your Mother No Teach video. Now that we have a general idea of how PSUs work, let's take a closer look at the anatomy of the power supply unit. Welcome to Gray's Anatomy, or in this case, PSU Anatomy. We're gonna take a look at the various components that are inside a PSU to see what they do for you. First up, we have filters. Not this type lah, editor. Before you change the AC power from the mains to a usable DC for your PC, also called as stepping down the voltage, you need to first smooth out the input voltage like a smooth criminal. So what makes input voltage not smooth or lumpy? Well, probably bad fitting underwear. All electrical devices emit electromagnetic signals and are constantly being switched on and off in places like our homes and our offices. This results in varying AC with occasional inconsistent spikes, which can make it difficult to convert into a usable DC. And it can also potentially damage the various components in your power supply unit. This is where filters come in. Transient filters, to be specific, are typically made up of capacitors and inductors. Capacitors act as speed bumps for sudden changes in the input voltage, while inductors use a magnetic field to push back, like a force field, when there are sudden spikes in the voltage. Next up, rectifiers. Now that we have a steady bombipit consistent flow of AC, the bridge rectifier then converts the AC to DC because your PC cannot use AC.
I'm on a highway to hell!
Too soon? Thirdly, there's the converter. It adjusts the flow of the current to take into the amount of all the components that store and release energy within the unit itself. Simply put, it ensures that your power supply is safe. Number 4. Transformers. More than meets the eye. Hey, stop printing!
Please help me rolling.
Rolling, rolling. You think I'm Autobots, ah?
Roll out.
This is the component that steps down the voltage from 240 volts from your main to 12 volts, 5 volts and 3.3 volts. Transformers use electromagnetic induction and a set of two coils of wires to step down the voltage. However, right before it reaches the transformer, the current is changed back to AC by a pulse width modulation circuit or PWM. As transformers only work with AC. The frequency of this AC voltage really affects how efficient your transformer is. The higher, the better. For instance, this PSU has three transformers. The large chunky boy here generates the 12 volt output, and then we have the medium size, a little bit more basic. That one generates the 5 volt output, and we have the small one, which is the isolator for the PWM circuit. And finally, we have the voltage regulators. When converting AC voltage into DC voltage, it doesn't always result in this constant, never wavering DC voltage because it's not 100% spot on. And this results in DC voltages that vary ever so slightly. And that is called ripple voltage. Basically, you want your ripple voltage to be as small as possible. That's not what she said. Voltage regulators help to provide a steady DC output to minimize the ripple voltage as much as possible. Now that we know how PSUs work and we understand the general anatomy of it because it's all naked in front of us, let's find out which of these components that manufacturers can, you know, skim on and be a cheapskate. Firstly, of course, we have the transient filters. When manufacturers skim out on filters, this will result in less filtering. You are then left with a very volatile voltage that could end up damaging your PSU and the rest of your PC. Another component manufacturers can cut costs on are rectifiers. Cheap rectifiers emit more heat, and as we all know, too much heat is the enemy of all electronics. And then we have converters, because not all converters are made equal, and an active power factor correction converter, or the APFC, so yang the name, is favored over passive converters, with the latter being cheaper but less effective, like lovers, that's what she said. While passive converters are fine in low power units, when they are used in high power units, you will end up with even less efficiency and a less safe power supply. Capacitors are used throughout the PSU and are present in many of the different parts, which is why you keep hearing brands shouting Japanese capacitors. Cheaper and unsuitably sized capacitors result in ripple voltage being less than ideal, which can lead to an unstable power supply. The capacity and efficiency of a power supply is good and all, but it doesn't actually tell you if a power supply is reliable, okay? So these are the components that you should watch out for when surveying your next PSU. Well, there's also the quality of the build and the solder, which is very well done in all three units that we cracked open right here. Also, we have the fan, which will tell you how quietly it's gonna run and how long it's gonna last, as well as the protection circuits. And since you can't just go into a store and then grab one and tear it open and look inside, it is important that you check with your trusted reviewers like Limpad. Subscribe now. For those of you guys who are keen to find out more about these three particular power supplies in front of us today, check this out. So the GP-UD850GM and also the UD1000GM are both used Japanese capacitors that have a long life. They also use a Jamicon HTLS bearing 120mm fan, which is supposed to perform close to a dual ball bearing in terms of specifications according to Jamicon. Of course, the fans on these power supplies will either slow down or stop during idle or low loads, which will lead to a longer lifespan for the fans. Then of course, we get all the protection circuits that you would need, which are the OVP, OPP, SCP, UVP, OCP, OTP, and all the P's, okay? This basically means that it's supposed to be more durable and less likely to succumb to, you know, explosions. Judging by the reviews on these newer models, we're not seeing any cause to be concerned. Lastly, we have the AP1200PM, which is a 1200W 80+ platinum modular power supply. This takes things to the next level in terms of aesthetics, and it has all the RGB that you'll need. So we have a customizable RGB lighting accents and a digital LCD monitor that you can adjust with the RGB Fusion 2.0. It will allow you to monitor the status of your PSU that's both flashy and also functional. You can also add custom GIFs, videos, and carousels. It also has a fan dust removal function, automatic. Every time you turn on your PC, it will just reverse the fan and blow out all the dust. But of course, you can also trigger this manually lah. And that is everything you need to know about the PSU, how it works and the inner beauty, as well as how to spot a dodgy one that might potentially... If you thought this video is awesome, don't forget to like and share and also subscribe to our YouTube channel and hit the notification bell to see more content like this, or follow us on Facebook and Instagram to see more shenanigans from us, or follow me on TikTok because I'm no longer a boomer. And also leave a comment down below if you have any questions regarding power supply units or any other questions regarding other PC or tech questions, and I'll try to reply to you individually at the bottom and also in the comment section. Gigabyte is having a PSU promotion at Just IT and Brightstar starting from today till the 31st of March. It is time to power up! For today's comment section, we're gonna reply to the Intel 12th Gen Power Limit i7 versus i9 of content creation. Okay, so we're gonna start with the wonderful world of YouTube. Firstly, we have Nishant Kumar that says that they don't need water cooling for these processors, air cooling is enough. Of course, if you use a quality air cooler like a Noctua, that should be fine. Also, based on our findings with the power limit, if you are lowering the power limit for certain workloads like gaming and also things like video editing, it should still be fine. But if you're doing 3D work, I still recommend that you get the biggest water cooler that you can. Custom loop would be best lah. If not, then at least AIO 360m. Millimeters and above. Firas Nazaini asked me if room ambient temperature will affect the temperature of your CPU and stuff like that. The answer is yes, of course lah, because the cooler the air you take in your intake, the cooler the temperature is gonna be, okay? Affecting by how much, this one you have to actually test lah, but Malaysia panas bro. Arifu Rahman say, underrated love from Bangladesh, my love also go to you. In a wonderful world of Facebook, Sawada Fuyu asked me if he just heard hashtag cheap buy the wrong way. Of course, because your otak dirty. Jay Haoyu tagged his best friend and said there's no such thing as overkill. That's correct, when it comes to coolers for 12th gen, there's really no such thing as overkill. And that's all for today. If you want me to reply to any of your questions, feel free to leave more comment lah. The more comment you comment, the more I can comment on your comment. And again, my name is Shane from Malt House, and I will see you in the next one. Bye.